atmosphere, and in particular changes in the field of ion current. And these have been modeled, as some of us saw yesterday afternoon, by global MHD simulations. And while global MHD simulations are fantastic and a workhorse in our field, there's some limitations in dealing with ELF waves, particularly at higher frequencies. And the other important point is that there's this so-called gap region in the global MHD simulations that's not modeled, and I'm going to show you why that's not modeled and some of our attempts to overcome that. One theme of this whole talk is that the propagation of MHD waves and alpha waves in particular is strongly affected by the inhomogeneities of the system. Basically, all the MHD modes are coupled whenever the system is not uniform, and the system is never uniform, so we have to deal with that. And that's why some of these linearized wave models that we've been developing give a good description of these waves. I will have these waves are supposed to give trigger warnings and all of this sort of thing. I will give a trigger warning, there will be math. So, and I tried running it through HKCD, but everything turned out red, and so I gave up. All right, so beyond that, first of all, I know some of you are not ULF wave specialists, so I'm going to start by giving a little introduction to ULF waves, giving some of the terminology and the buzzwords that we use, talk about some of the important interactions like field line resonances and the concept of phase mixing, and also how ULF waves interact with the ionosphere. Then I'm going to review some of the work that's been done in global MHD models in terms of the response of the system to various transients in the magnetosphere, and then I'm going to talk about the sort of linearized wave models that our group has been developing and describe, show you a couple of examples, including PI2 propagations, colloidal PC4 waves, and the higher frequency waves in the ULF band, like PC1s and PI1s. And those are the ones in particular that are difficult to model in the global simulation groups. All right, so here's something that I hope most everybody in the room is aware of. In MHD, there are three linear wave modes, and they're easily classified by their phase speed. And we start off at the lowest phase speed in a low beta plasma is the slow mode, which is basically an ion acoustic wave in the low beta limit. And this is a wave that balances, it serves to balance the plasma and magnetic pressure along the magnetic field for the most part. And the propagation of this wave is described by the electron pressure balancing ion inertia. The so-called intermediate wave, which is the one they would be focusing on, goes by the name of Schur alpha wave. Of course, one thing I always tell my students is that any wave in plasma physics that's worth its salt has at least three different names, so this is something that has to be taken into account. But the Schur alpha wave, again, given the ideal MHD dispersion relation here, it propagates along the magnetic field and is guided along the magnetic field, which is why, as we'll see, it can produce its field line resonances. And of course, the physics of this wave is magnetic tension balanced by ion inertia. And then finally, there's the fast mode or the magnetosonic wave, which is, as the name indicates, sort of a magnetized sound wave, where both the magnetic pressure and the plasma pressure play a role. And this is important for transmitting pressure fluctuations across magnetic fields. So the point is that the dispersion relations that I've listed here, and that we all probably learned in your plasma physics class, are valid for uniform plasma. But of course, as I mentioned before, the system is not homogeneous, so we have to deal with the coupling of those waves. All right, some of the buzzwords. Now, MHD waves, a long time ago, before people really realized what they were, just looking at wiggles on ground magnetometers, were classified as either PC or PI waves, either continuous or irregular, and they were given a number. You know, this was all official IUGG sort of terminology based on their frequency range and their period range, and those ranges are listed here with the lower numbers being higher frequencies. And of course, this notation continues to be used, even though there's really, you know, it's just a coincidence that certain types of physics is associated with PC5s or PC2s or whatever. So take that somewhat with a grain of salt. Again, as the magnetospheric physicists in the room know, we will deal with the dipole field, which is characterized by the Maclaurin-L parameter, which gives you the equatorial distance of a field line or a radii. And I'll also be referring to dipole coordinates where nu, which is basically 1 over L for technical reasons, is the outward direction. It's actually radially outward at the equator, and as the field line moves towards the pole, it becomes polar. Phi is the usual azimuthal coordinate that we usually describe in terms of magnetic local time, and we use mu as a symbol for the field aligned coordinate in this case. These waves in a simple geometry can be characterized by an azimuthal mode number, basically showing how many waves are present around as you go around the Earth. So we'll refer to waves of various M ranges. And then we also refer to toroidal and poloidal waves. Toroidal waves are waves that are associated with the motion of the field line sort of in the azimuthal direction, and so are associated with a V5 component and an E nu component, which through the E cross B drift is a phi motion. And then the poloidal waves are sort of like the waves that go in and out like that, and I guess I'm going to use that in case you know, in and out waves. And those are also important. So I'll be using those terms right there. Now at low values of M, less than about 10 or so, the poloidal mode is usually coupled to the compressional component of the magnetic field, so it's more like the fast mode, while the toroidal mode is the one that's guided along the field and is more like the shear alpha mode. At high end, those roles are reversed, so that's something to keep in mind. Here's sort of a typical parameter. This is the one I'll actually use in some of the simulations I'll show later. This first figure shows the density of a dipole region of the dipole field, and you can see that there's very, very low density in the outer magnetosphere versus near the ionosphere, the density is higher. And then we have this plasmasphere region where it's relatively dense plasma. And if we convert this to an Alphane speed, I guess I didn't point out that the Alphane speed is the magnetic field divided by the square root of the mass density times some constants. And of course that's, so it's inversely proportional to the density, so the plasmasphere looks like a hole in the Alphane speed. And so this is the sort of a picture that we have. Now, the important point of the fact that these Alphane waves are guided along the field is that if you can think of them as sort of waves on a string, and since the ionosphere to the lowest approximation is a good conductor, you can think of these strings as being tied down at the two ionospheres. And just like you have various harmonic modes on a guitar or violin string, you have these various harmonic structures. And people like Kazumi Takahashi, who's here, and Brian Anderson have studied these waves. And by looking at the frequency of these waves, you can determine the mass density, the typical mass density along the field line. Note that these waves are typically in the 10 to 20 millihertz range, which is periods of 50 to 100 seconds. Now, the excitation, the way these field line resonances are often excited is by a process called linear mode conversion. And in the low end limit, again, we can think of compressional waves as being caused by various things like dynamic pressures and fluctuations in the solar wind, the Kelvin Helmholtz instability along the flanks. On the night side, it can be excited by fast flows that come in from the tail. People like to talk about things like dipolarization fronts during substorms. At M exactly equal to zero, these two modes are decoupled, and you can have the compressional mode would be like sometimes called a breathing mode, where the whole field goes in and out, whereas the shear mode is the whole is one L shell oscillating as a mutant. As we go to finite M, then this introduces mode coupling between the shear and the compressional waves. One point that I'll make here in a moment is that high M waves, like waves that have M greater than 40 or 50, are generally shielded from the inner magnetosphere. And those sort of waves have to be generated internally. So we talk about external and internal sources of ULF waves. Just to illustrate this, the fast flow, again, taking guidance from the dispersion relation while noting that it's not exactly true. Of course, then the fast mode wave and the cold plasma limit is dependent on the entire wave, the wave vector. And so it has to be bigger than any given component of the wave vector. And the azimuthal component can be given by M divided by the distance from the dipole axis, r sine theta. And so the frequency is at a given frequency. frequency, only m's with smaller, only smaller values of m can propagate in. And this figure for the density profiles that I showed in the earlier slide gives the cutoff value for m. So for example, if you have an m equals 10 weight, it's going to be confined to, that's externally driven, it's going to be confined to this outer region of the field lines. Okay, the other point that's important in the development of these field line resonances is a process called phase mixing. And the idea here is if you have two field lines that have different alphane speeds on them, then if you start off with a uniform phase front, it's going to kind of shear out, and that's going to lead to a decrease in the perpendicular wavelength of the wave. And of course, gradients like this are always present in the magnetosphere, particularly in boundary regions like the plasma sheet boundary layer or the plasma quads, or in a more local sense, in the boundaries of the auroral density cavities, which is illustrated by this next figure from Chris Chaston. And you can do some modeling about this and showing that the structure that you get from this phase mixing is inversely proportional to the Pedersen conductance, which is something that I might need to talk about. I'm not sure if I'll get to that. Another important aspect of ULF wave dynamics is their reflection from the ionosphere. And this is a classic photo or cartoon from Mallinckrodt and Carlson back before most of the people in this room, I think, were born. And the idea here is that if an alphane wave comes in, this is kind of displaced to illustrate the point. If an alphane wave comes in, hits the ionosphere, the ionosphere is highly conducting, so it's going to tend to short out the electric field of that alphane wave. And the reflected alphane wave is going to come back with an oppositely directed electric field, and the magnetic perturbation, which is into the plane of the board in this figure, is going to be in the same direction. So this is the idea, and mathematically this is associated with a concept called the alphane conductance, although for the electrical engineers it's properly an admittance, which is inversely proportional to the alphane speed. And as any transmission line engineer knows, if you don't terminate your transmission line properly, it will cause reflections. And in this case, that means that the sigma A has to equal the Pedersen conductance. And in the case, which is the more typical case where sigma P is greater than sigma A, we have this reversal of the electric field, and we get this reflection coefficient that depends on the difference between them. I won't get into it in this talk, but there's various corrections that you can make due to Hall conductance and paraelectric fields and things like that to this conductance. But actually, all of them can be, the reflection can always be described in this way with those modifications. Okay, so moving on to the second part. There have been a number of efforts, most recently, in the last 6 or 7 years, to use global MHD models to model ULF waves. Seth Clottier, who's here, right over there, was a pioneer in all of this, and Jody Reeve at UCLA has done some. She and Raiders in the New Hampshire group have been looking at this sort of thing. And of course, the advantages of this approach are the advantages of global MHD. It's a fully nonlinear, self-consistent MHD description of the plasma, magnetosphere. Magnetic geometry is totally self-consistent. You can directly drive these models from the solar wind. And one thing that's going to be important for the MHD modes is that it's an open system, so the waves can propagate out of the tail, which is, of course, a bit more realistic than putting in some boundaries like I'll show you later. So one of the things you can do, nice thing you can do with a global MHD mode is you can either put in a real solar wind input and model a particular event, which of course is commonly done by people in this room, or the other thing you can do is you can put in an idealized solar wind and describe and do a numerical experiment where you see how the system responds. And Seth did a study like this in 2010 using the Lyon-Frederick Mowbray model. And of course, I admit I'm not giving a tutorial on global MHD modeling. I'm sure somewhere in the past somebody gave a gem tutorial on this subject in previous years. It's one on its own. But what he did is he drove them to the LFM model with a sinusoidal dynamic pressure variation at various frequencies, and the figure shown here is for the 10 millihertz case. And the thing you can see here, first of all, the first figure here is the equatorial plane, and when you drive, when you hit the system with an impressional pulse near noon, the field of line currents and the shear alpha waves tend to be generated on the edges of that compression. So as you see here, you get the major electric fields in this case at about 15 and 20 and 9 o'clock MLT. The middle figure here in the first row represents the meridional plane at 15 MLT, and you can see right here at L equals 7 a nice bright structure, and that is the field line resonant. That's the field line that resonates at that 10 millihertz case, and you can see it here both in the electric field and in the magnetic field. And the other thing that's shown here is a spectrogram and a plot of the field. Now, one thing that some of the experts in the room might say, oh, this doesn't look like a fundamental wave, there's these nodes in there, but that's because he's plotting the cylindrical radial component. Since the field line kind of has a peak and then falls over, there's this node in here. But if you did this in terms of the dipolar coordinate, which is always perpendicular to the field, it would be just like a half of a sine wave, qualitatively. The Nasir and Rashidov have used the open GGCM simulations to study sudden impulses, and they were doing this in a number of different cases for different events, and not all of them, but about a quarter of them showed evidence of field line resonances. Whether or not why the other ones didn't is a question of that I won't get into. But the simulations are suggestive that you have these vortex structures that form because of the pressure imbalance, and Dave Seibach talked about that a long time ago. And this vortex structure is exactly the sort of thing that can convert to shear mode waves. This is the sort of driver that we classically think of for the field of line resonances. So this is another story about that. Another aspect of this that's been studied is PI2 pulsations, and for those of you that are not aware of this, PI2s are a type of pulsation that's associated with substorms. Not my general point of view is that these PI2s are associated with bursty bulb flows, and that's not a universal opinion. But it's true that during substorms we have these strong localized flows that come into the system. And global NHD models, including the UCLA group, Jody Ring et al., and Fujita and Tanaka in Japan have been used to study this. And this is also an interesting ULF subject in its own right. The very front of these BBFs, which is sometimes referred to as a dipolarization front, often has a slow-mode character, which with the magnetic field and the plasma pressure out of phase. But it can also launch a fast mode wave that runs ahead of the structure. That fast mode wave can convert to field line resonances in the intermagnetosphere. And in addition, on the side, the BBFs are localized in local time. And so at the edges of those, there's a shear in the velocity, and that can lead to field line current generation as well. And there's been a lot of interesting studies in recent years about this. In particular, I point to one by Panoff et al., which show that these bursty bulb flows, when they hit the intermagnetosphere, sometimes ring and oscillate at frequencies that are typical of PI2s, which I should mention are around 1 minute period. There's a range, of course, 40 to 150 seconds is the official definition, but 1 minute's a nice number to think about. Another aspect of these, and this is part of some of the studies of PI2s recently, is that when these waves come into the plasmasphere, they can set up what's called a plasmaspheric virtual resonance, which was studied by Don Lee and Kanye Kim. I really always have to use the first name. And they've hypothesized that we see these cavity waves. And so here's some of the results from Jody Ream's paper. She used two different types of models, the model at UCLA, basically a Jimmy Rader's model, and the LFL model to describe the response of the system. And the nice thing here, I don't know, you can't see all the wiggly lines, but the thing that they've shown here is a plot of radial distance versus time. And these are very nice for seeing these sorts of waves, because you can you can see the propagation of these waves, sort of a quasi-periodic fluctuation in these cases that's associated with these, basically the signature of these PI2 type of fluctuations. Now, one of the things about these global MHD models that I've talked to up till now is that they have no plasmasphere present in them. There's technical reasons for that, which I won't get into. But more recently, as Claude Pierre has done some of the first global simulations that have included a plasmasphere, other people have done some of those plasmasphere models, but Seth Kahn was the one who concentrated on ULF wave models. And of course, now the LFM model has been coupled to ring current models, or in this case, the Rice convection model, that can better describe the intermagnetosphere. And when we have a dense plasmasphere, as I showed in that earlier slide, that reduces the outfang speed, and it also creates this cavity in the plasmasphere. And you can see here in the top row is the simulation results. And again, this is, what is this, electric fields. It's the toroidal, the colloidal, and the component of the electric field, and the compressional component of the magnetic field. And you can see, here you can see the field line resonance type of structure, which mainly shows up in the toroidal mode, and some compressional wave power. But when you include a plasmasphere here, you can see the lowering of the field line resonance frequency due to the lower outfang speed here in this plasmaspheric region. And you can also see these waves trapped, compressional waves trapped inside the plasmasphere. So this is just published this year. It's a very recent result and extremely nice results in this case. Now, I want to mention a couple of reasons why, and you know, I hope the MHD modelers don't get all mad at me, but a couple of reasons why there are some limitations in this model. And one of them, to get into some technical details, is something called the Courant condition, which numerical modelers all know and love, quote unquote. A fundamental stability condition for a finite difference code like this is the Courant condition, or sometimes CFL, Courant, Friedrichs, and Levy, I think, is the people who determine this. And that says that the time step that you use in your simulation has to be smaller than your spatial step divided by a characteristic velocity. Or in words, that means that information cannot move more than one spatial grid size in one time step. If you violate this condition, you have a very nice instability that crashes your code and saves you a lot of computer time. There are codes that will run and give totally lousy results and keep on running happily as they go along. It's a lot better if it crashes. So the idea behind this is that if you want to improve the spatial resolution of your code, you also have to use a smaller time step, which of course limits how much spatial resolution you want to put in your code. And of course, the other problem with it is that the wave speeds are high, and of course, this speed could be a wave speed or a convection speed, any sort of speed like that. Then you also need higher spatial resolution in there. And in global MHD models, of course, you want to model the whole system, and you're using a very accurate and complicated algorithm to do so. So you have limited spatial resolution. And in this 2010 paper, Seth did this. It's easier to say Seth. His name is not Pierre, but we'll go over it again. did this thing where the blue curve here is the spectrum of an input fluctuation at the upstream edge of the simulation. And the green curve is the result even 10RA before you even get to the magnetosphere. And you can see that there's a sort of roll-off in the structure around 10 or 20 millihertz. And this is basically the fact that if the wavelength of the wave starts to become comparable or even smaller than your spatial grid size, then you can't properly describe the wave. And so this is one basic limitation and one reason why the global MHD people, when they're doing these things, are mainly talking about PC5 waves, very long period of fluctuations. The other consequence of this is that near the Earth, I didn't point it out in the figures, but the outfang speed becomes very large. And so for that reason, among others, these global MHD simulations tend to have their inner boundary around 2 or 3 RE. And this is famously known as the gap region, which is sort of an unfortunate name because it implies that nothing happens in that region, whereas, of course, in the Oural Zone, that's where the particle acceleration takes place, but this isn't in the Oural Zone time. What people do in these cases, which isn't a bad thing to do, is they basically say that
propagation through this region is instantaneous, which the alpha-N speed's high, so that's not so bad. And then they use current continuity in the ionosphere to describe the coupling. And then, of course, there's other algorithms that vary in different codes for dealing with the conductivity and how it changes with precipitation and stuff like that. And the idea in a lot of these codes is you'll take the everybody does it a little bit differently, but if you take the field line current that's coming out of the bottom end of your simulation, you solve this equation for the potential, you map that potential back up to the inner boundary of your simulation, and that gives you an electric field, and then therefore an E cross B velocity. And so this is the thing that people do in this region. The other deep, dark, dirty secret of bubble MHD is something called Morris correction. Again, the alpha, you have to use very small time steps where the speed is high. So one solution to that is to limit the speed. Now, in the real world, we have a thing called the displacement current, and that actually, if you include that in the MHD equations, that limits the alpha N speed to a speed that is less than the speed of light, which of course keeps Einstein happy. And of course Einstein's pretty happy this year. And that's an important correction. But Jay Boris back in 1970 realized that you could put in an artificially low speed of light, and that would allow for a larger time step. And usually people that are very careful about this and do this in a way that doesn't compromise their results. But it can be hard to do this for ULF wave studies because it can lead to incorrect frequencies. So as a result of all of this, and moving to the final part of my talk, we've developed a set of linearized models which don't include all of the global MHD, all of the complications of MHD, but because we can do that, we can make a very simple algorithm that can run very fast, and so we can get away with using smaller and smaller time steps. So we can use a very good description of the ionosphere. And so since we can do higher frequency waves, since we can do smaller spatial steps, we can do and temporal steps, we can do higher frequency waves. And in particular, these are very nicely simplified by the use of what we call dipolar coordinates. So here's some of the math that I mentioned before. This dipolar coordinate system has been commonly used for decades now. Of course, here the solid lines are dipole field lines. I've forgotten about the end of the Earth in here, so everything's going down the surface. And the dashed lines are lines that are perpendicular to those dipolar coordinates. And you can see if you treat this as a coordinate, and this is this coordinate I called mu before, which is increasing along the field line. And for each of these, in this type of coordinate system, you introduce scale factors. It's like when you put the r and the r sine theta in cylindrical or spherical coordinates. And so we have the same sort of scale factors that basically give the distance between, the physical distance between two points that have a certain coordinate difference. And this is a very useful structure. And of course, again, more things you can write. The nice thing about these linearized models is you're basically modeling the curl equations of Maxwell. And curls are particularly nice to use in these coordinate systems. And again, I don't expect you to read this, but I think this is all going to go up on a web page. So if you want to look up the reference for this later on, you can. And again, you can see this, if you look at these carefully, if you drop the phi dependence, which is that m equals zero limit, you get the, you can see this decoupling between e nu and b phi, which describe the shear mode, or the toroidal mode in this case, and the other three components, which give the toroidal mode. Of course, this is ideal MHD, so there's no parallelectric field in these models that can be added later. So these are very advantageous coordinates, but the other problem with this is that we still have to deal with this high alpha speed near the Earth. And in particular, if I go back here, you'll notice that these dashed lines of constant mu are not at a constant radial distance. You know, if I draw a circle at 1RE here, these field lines cross that. You'd like your boundary to be at a nice simple coordinate. So if we do that, if we modify this, we can develop a non-orthogonal coordinate system that we
developed a number of years ago, where we just basically changed that U coordinate. We're using a different notation, U1, U2, U3 here. And that kind of distorts these coordinate surfaces so that they do conform with the surface of the Earth, or actually more precisely the ionosphere, as we get close to the Earth. So we can use these coordinates nicely. It makes everything really a nice mess, and I won't go through all of this, but we're basically talking differential geometry here. So if you've ever taken, probably most physicists only do this in general relativity, but it's actually just nice mathematics. We have things like metric tensors and Jacobians that give us the volume of the thing. And again, this is the sort of thing that's up for looking on the website later on. But here's a more useful way of thinking about it, is that in these non-orthogonal systems, you have two sets of basis vectors. You have what are called the contravariant and covariant basis vectors. And this coordinate system has the nice advantage that the contravariant component E1 is always perpendicular to the field, and E sub 3, the covariant component, is always parallel to the field. And in the ionosphere, the coordinate system is set up so that the covariant E1 is horizontal and northward, and basically in the latitudinal direction, and the E2 is radial, and of course this field line, this coordinate system goes in the direction of the field, so the coordinate increases from the southern hemisphere to the northern hemisphere. And again, actually, wave equations are even simpler in these cases, because these covariant and contravariant components very nicely take into account the mapping. Everybody talks about mapping electric fields to the ionosphere and things like that, and this is all very naturally taken care of. So for the mathematicians in the room, this is really an elegant type of system to work with. All right, enough of those equations. I know you don't want to deal with all that. So let's look at some of the results we get from this. And the first example I'm going to show is modeling VIT pulsations. And so what we did here is, and again, the problem with the disadvantage of these types of models is we don't have a solar wind coming in. We have to kind of artificially drive the system. So we might think of these as doing numerical experiments to see how the system responds. And what we did is, in this case, is we drove the model by a compressional pulse at midnight. That's an oscillation, basically a damped oscillation that has a period of 50 seconds. And I'm showing this figure here because I'm going to show a movie of this in the next slide, just to orient you. The left-hand column is the B mu, which is an indicator of the compressional mode in the simulation. And E nu is characteristic of the shear alphane mode. Here you can see the various compressions, and I'll point out here, here's the midnight meridian in the top row, and the bottom row is the equatorial plane. And so one thing I'll point out here is you can see this blob here and corresponding blob down here. That's in the plasmasphere. This is this plasmaspheric resonance, as you'll see in the movie. And then over here in the shear mode, you can see the particular field lines are lighting up in this case. And those are the field line resonances that we see in this model. And of course, you can see those in the equatorial plane by these sort of asymmetrically extended streaks. So here I'll show the movie again. This is the same. There we go. There it is. All right, so here comes the wave in. It starts to excite. One thing you'll notice is that initially the electric field is kind of shielded from the plasmasphere, but eventually it gets in there. You can see the development of the field line resonance. You can see this cavity mode happily oscillating away. And again, this is kind of thinking that this is being continually driven, so you have this other mode. And then you can see, in fact, in this nice final case, you can see this field line just outside the plasmasphere, which is lit up in terms of the field line resonance. So this is the kind of thing I show. There's just one more in case you didn't see all that in the first place. It's kind of, these are always fun to watch. You can sit here and be mesmerized for hours if you don't want to, do something other than work. So it's kind of a nice way of visualizing how these modes come about. Just to be a little bit more quantitative about it, if you look at the azimuthal component of B, or the compressional component of B and the azimuthal component of E inside the plasmasphere, you can see this virtual resonance. Plasmasphere here is L equals 4, which is this field line here. And now in this case, you can see the solid line is the magnetic field.
dashed line of the electric field, and you can see the 90-degree phase shift between those two waves, indicating nearly a standing wave in this structure. Another example, which is I'm going to talk because it's the result of my recent PhD student, Charles McHenry, is in terms of PC4 pulsations. Now, these PC4s that have been described has done a couple of studies using Van Allen probes to study these modes, and sometimes they come, waves in this frequency range come up to be compressional, and sometimes they're non-compressional. And the idea here is the non-compressional ones, as indicated in those earlier slides, tend to be the higher M modes. And we said those can't be externally driven, as I argued earlier. The idea is these M modes are cut off. So in order to model these sorts of waves, and again, this is sort of an artificial way of doing it, but it illustrates how the waves propagate, you can introduce a fluctuating current source into the system. In this case, it was done at L equals 5. And this is a version of the model, by the way, that's not fully three-dimensional, because at high M, of course, you need lots of zones in the azimuthal direction in order to resolve those waves. So instead, we just assume that the fields all vary like the IM phi and replace the phi derivatives with IMs. And you get pyramidal, toroidal, and compressional structures. You can see that these waves are more localized towards the field line that's being excited. Actually, we see a nice little third harmonic popping up near the edge of the simulation as well, which is kind of cute. So these are really nice results, and then he has a number of others in his thesis, and presumably will be published someday, but he's off working for great research, and so they're keeping him pretty busy, so I'm not sure when that paper's going to come out, but hopefully soon. So that's another nice result. Now, in the last part of my talk now, I want to move to higher frequency waves, sort of PC1, PI1 waves. Now we're talking about waves with periods of 1 to 10 seconds. And we've done some studies of this, and the important part here, as I'll argue, is that in these cases, the high integrated ionosphere model that we mostly have been using and are used in most of the global simulations breaks down. I'll tell you why in a minute. But we have to consider the full ionospheric structure. We have the Hall conductivity in this case has the role of coupling shear alphane and fast modes as well. And so we have this whole interesting structure. The other thing that occurs here is that above the ionosphere, the alphane speed increases very rapidly. This is going up in RE, up to 4 RE in a model. And the alphane speed is up, and again, actually, in this case, 100,000 kilometers a second, a third of the speed of light. So speed of light correction is important in these models, and we do put in that correction at a real value of C. And here's the first 2,000 kilometers of altitude showing the models that we use for the Hall conductivity, the Pedersen conductivity, and in fact, there's even a parallel conductivity in the model, which doesn't matter all that much. Now, conductivity is interesting because this is, again, an interesting mathematical point in that if you look at the equations for including the ionospheric Ohm's law, you can write them in this matrix form. And if you diagonalize this matrix, you get eigenvalues that are sigma p plus or minus I sigma h. And when you and this is actually a nice way of modeling these waves. This is actually the way we model it in the case, because if you decompose it in this way, the ionospheric equation for the electric field becomes very simple. Here, this f represents the curl over b, and you can model this very, you can integrate this very directly. But the interesting thing to note is that you get these exponentials of the eigenvalues, and that means sigma p corresponds to a decay of the wave, and sigma h corresponds to a rotation of the wave speed. And this is something that ULF wave experimenters know very well. The magnetic field you see at the ground is 90 degrees rotated from from the downward magnetic field in space. And this is, I thought this was a great illustration of how the mathematics very clearly shows this rotation effect that's sometimes called the Hughes rotation, because Jeff Hughes studied that back in 1974. Now, the other part of that is that since you're including these cases, we don't have an electrostatic ionosphere anymore. The ionosphere has an inductive component, electromagnetic component,
And instead of using this electrostatic boundary condition, we can simply, at the bottom of the system, we still have to have a boundary, and we put a little current sheet at the bottom there, and the just using Maxwell's equations again, the current across that current sheet is proportional to the difference in the transverse magnetic field across that sheet. So we can do this condition. It looks a little bit funny, but if you take the divergence of it in simple case, you get an equation that's basically the current continuity equation, but it includes this inductive field associated with the curl of E that's coupled by the Hall conductance in this case. And you can also take the curl of this equation and get an equation that's corresponding to basically a boundary condition for the fast flow in this particular situation. Now, this case, this second equation is important because this is the delta means the difference between above and below the ionosphere sheet. So the radial component of the magnetic field is continuous by Maxwell's equation, but its derivative can have a kink in it. And that kink is important for being a source for this equation. And in order to find that, we need to know the field below the ionosphere. So we have to calculate the field down in the atmosphere. And that we do very simply by assuming the atmosphere is an insulator and the Earth is a conductor, which are both approximately true, but as we saw in the talks earlier this week, not totally true. And we can do spherical harmonic analysis in order to do this. It's somewhat modified by the fact that we want to conform with our boundary conditions in the model. So these aren't the normal YLMs, they're sort of a modified YLM. But that, as a bonus, that gives us an actual direct calculation of the ground magnetic field. We don't have to do any EOSR integration to find the ground magnetic field. As I mentioned earlier, sigma p causes a decay of the waves. And so this is an illustration of this so-called atmospheric shielding effect. If you look at Jackson, you see that there's a skin depth as you try to put a wave into a conductor that looks like this. And this skin depth at this frequencies of approaching 1 hertz becomes significant and becomes similar to the size of the ionosphere. And as you see, this was a broadband simulation driven by a broadband source. And you see some structure here, which is actually the ionospheric alpha resonator, and then at higher frequencies, it all decays away. And here's the electric field as we go through the ionosphere. I hope that it didn't get cut off, but it's 1,000 kilometers altitude, 500, 250, and 150. You can see how the field is filtered out by the thing. So this is to illustrate the importance of these higher frequencies of dealing with the full ionosphere. I hope some senior people are still around here to note that we do, some of us do understand that the ionosphere is not an infinitely thin sheet. All right, I mentioned this ionospheric alpha resonator, which I've spent a little bit of my life thinking about. The idea here is that the alpha speed, as I said, rises very rapidly. It's low in the dense ionosphere. But it rises very rapidly, particularly on auroral field lines where there's where the density goes down quite low, and the alphane speed comes up. And when you have this big gradient in the alphane speed, that can be a reflector. It's like a again, I just taught Jackson last semester, so I'm thinking in terms of Jackson. It's like the old problem of putting a wave in between two different dielectric media, and a sharp gradient in the effective dielectric constant, you get a reflection. You also get a reflection of the ionosphere. And as opposed to a field line resonance where you're bouncing between one ionosphere and the other, and then you get periods the order of minutes, here this has periods the order of seconds. So everything that you can do with field line resonances, you can do much faster with these ionospheric resonators. And again, this has these periods of 1 to 10 seconds. So that we have this structure, this becomes very important for these higher frequency waves. And just to illustrate this, this shows electric and magnetic field structures. And you can see it's a little bit hard to see here because this goes up to 2 RE. But you can see right here the ionosphere, you get sort of a fundamental and then a harmonic type of structure showing up. Maybe a little bit easier to see in the magnetic field structures. So this is kind of cute stuff. One nice result that's come out of this, again from my former graduate student Jesse Woodruff,
is that he did some studies about this. The other thing about this ionospheric resonator is the shear wave is trapped along the field line, so it just goes up and down. The fast mode wave can propagate in a wave, basically in a waveguide that goes along there. And so these waves propagate away from their source. And Jesse just made this nice figure from his simulation showing that the polarization has this sort of a quadrupolar pattern. The blue is what left-handed waves, and the red is right-handed waves, and there's little holograms at each grid point here, and you get this sort of a four-fold structure in the polarizations with the polarization ellipses oriented in a particular way towards the field. And this is consistent with some of the earlier work that's been done on this propagation by people like Brian Fraser and Mark Engelbrecht. Another thing at high frequencies are these so-called Hurl packets. And this is a nice one because it shows the trapping in the resonator. This is three different frequencies. This one in this model is a resonator frequency. This is a little bit off resonance, and this is too high. So here you can see in this one, this is pointing flux in the color picture. You can see the waves. Again, this is altitude versus time. You can see the waves bouncing around quite happily in the resonator. And in the ground signature, you can see this extended wave train of wave packets coming through. So that's kind of a neat little thing. Again, at 2 hertz, you're above this shielding cutoff, and the wave doesn't even make it down to the E layer where the ground signature can be produced. So those were all from a model that has 2D. I wanted to show a couple of pictures from a 3D case, and this is the final results I'm going to show. The most recent things that we've been doing is looking at A9 conductivity variations. And in this case, what we do is we have a day side model and a night side model for the ionosphere, and we vary between them based on the solar zenith angle at the foot point of the field line. And so in this case, again, noon is to the left, and so we have high conductivity. This is in the northern and the southern ionosphere. In this case, we put the sun at the equator to model equinox conditions, so the northern hemisphere and the southern hemisphere look the same. And we can drive on the day side. We get nice field line resonances on the day side, not so much on the night side. We get some fields coming in here. It's hard to see the numbers, but these are about 5 times smaller than these guys here. So some wave power gets over to the night side, but you really don't see a very distinct field line resonance signature. Whereas if you drive on the night side, again, this is the day side figure and the night side figure. Again, you're driving on the night side, so you'll see those resonances, but you also see field line resonances over on the day side. And this is, and in this case, these on the opposite side are only twice as small as over here. So the idea is that in the day side ionosphere where the conductivity is high, the fields are, the wave can be, it's not dissipated so much. So that's kind of a nice thing. And here you can see, again, I mentioned you can measure the ground fields directly, or calculate the ground field directly. Again, here's day side driving and night side driving. Day side driving, you don't see anything on the ground really from the structure here. Whereas on the night side here, over the afternoon and in the morning sector, you can see these sort of L-shell aligned curves, which are illustrating the field line resonance. Another thing to point in this case is that the Hall conductivity is very important, because the Hall conductivity breaks the non-Bessel symmetry in this case. The dragging in this case was all nice and symmetric. But here you can see, because of the Hall conductivity, there's a distortion of the wave pattern that occurs in this case, which is an interesting aspect of that thing. And the final thing I'm going to show, which is just kind of cute, is that we can also move the sun around and put it at off the equator, and in this case, we put it 23 degrees north of the equator. And now the northern ionosphere and the southern ionosphere are different. And especially at the terminator, there's a big difference between the conductance in the northern ionosphere and in the southern ionosphere. And this can give rise to what have been called quarter waves, and Yuki Obata recently published some observational studies of these. And we did the same sort of simulation, and here we show figures right at the terminator at 6 mLT, and you can see the electric field is strongest
on the southern ionosphere, no conductivity side, the magnetic field on the north, on the northern ionosphere. And the third panel here is the field line pointing flux, which, again, the yellows and the reds would mean towards the north, and blues and blacks towards the south. And you can see the field line structure is very much towards the south in this case. And these are kind of fun to watch in the movie. These are again the electric field and the magnetic field. And you can see how those structures develop and circulate around and develop this sort of structure. Just one more case in terms of the pointing flux. You can see it starts off, everything's going towards the Earth, red up there and blue down there. And then it starts to, after it bounces off the ionosphere a couple of times, it starts to develop this structure going mainly into the southern ionosphere. This actually was observed many years ago by a guy named Hans Junger, who was one of my colleagues when I was a postdoc in Germany. So this is a nice kind of resonance thing to look at. Alright, so here's this is my final slide, just looking at the limitations of the model. Of course, obviously, this is just a simple kind of toy model. Of course, we in this model so far, we've just assumed that the conductivity is static, it's constant. We know from previous studies that there's this structure called the ionospheric feedback instability, which can cause very small-scale structures in the system. And of course, we also just, and again, if there's senior people in the audience, they're saying, well, you can't just use a simple conductivity model. You need to use a full ionospheric and thermospheric dynamics. And Antonius Otto and Sidorangelo Rankin in Canada have made some early studies of this sort of case. But for the most part, these dynamic corrections are higher order. And the other thing I wanted to talk about, but I realized I wouldn't have time, is kinetic alpha waves, and that's a whole separate talk. And the idea here is that if we have electron inertia, if we include the finite electron inertia, remember the theorist that missed above the duck by not including the electron mass. If you include the electron mass, you can get parallel field acceleration and make auroras. Electron pressure can also come in, and I'm being egotistical, I'm just putting our references in there, but of course a number of other people have worked on this. And the newest development in this is some work done primarily by Claire Watt and Peter Damiano, where they're starting to do hybrid models and thinking about things like trapping and stuff in these kinetic alpha waves. So that's another real interesting and active subject of research that we do. So that's the symbol of the talk is over. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thanks, Bob. Time partner to play. This works.
Virtual resonance,
right? In your model.
We have plasmasphere in the resonance in the model, yes.
Yeah, so that means you observe positions outside of the plasma pulse as well as inside the plasmasphere, right?
Well, yeah, right. And in the model that we showed, we're driving from the tail. So the waves that create basically field line resonances outside the plasmasphere. So you see the shear mode waves primarily outside the plasmasphere, and the compressional modes not inside the plasmasphere.
I mean, does the plasmasphere resonance observed inside the plasmasphere leak outside of the plasma?
Oh, yes, yeah, that's true. It's not a sharp boundary. It's a fuzzy boundary. So yes, the plasmasphere resonance does have
observed outside
the
plasmasphere. Okay, so where is the strongest PRT positions observed of this kind of resonance? It's near the plasma pulse, slightly inside plasma pulse, or outside of plasma pulse?
You know, I can't give you an answer to that. My suspicion is that it's inside the plasmasphere, but I would have to check to see with the latitudinal structure. That's a very good suggestion.
I'm very glad to see that.
Yes.
One more question. Sorry. So does the propagation fast wave from the magnetic tail penetrate into the plasma sphere?
Yes. The question was, is the wave from the outside penetrate into the plasma sphere? And yes, that is the case.
So
the boundary is not perfect.
So you do observe the mixture of the propagation fast wave and the resonance, right?
That's right. The modes are coupled, so you see both compressional and fast and shear mode waves.
Okay, so do you use a spheric plasma sphere modeling or uniform ones, like with a
right? In the models that I showed here, the plasma sphere was symmetric in local time.
Okay.
Of course, the Hubbard boundary is field aligned. So.
Okay, so the frequencies, day side, night side, and different air values, they are kind of all the same, right? The period of the period.
Yes.
Okay. Thank
so
you.
One more final question from actually, this is more a comment. First of all, thanks for a great talk. I really did it. I guess I'd just like to add that there could be another separate talk on the internal beam sided rays. You mentioned them briefly, but there's a lot of great, you know, MHD and kinetic theory involved in the description of those waves too, as you know.
Yeah, you're quite right. I mean, the internally generated waves, of course, that gets a little more complicated because you have to start worrying about different bounce resonances and all the kinetics. And of course, there were, I'm sorry, I forgot the person's name, but there have been some nice initial studies on that using the CRCM, I believe it was, that were presented at this meeting. So that's certainly a good direction and perhaps a suggestion for a tutorial next year.
Great.